Good day from Washington. I am Robert Christian, and this is the Robert Christian Show. A former police officer charged of raping and sexually victimizing women while on his beat in a low-income Oklahoma City neighborhood was ordered this last week to spend the rest of his life plus 262 years in prison for preying on women in 2013 and 2014. District Judge Timothy Hendon said, and he agreed, that this officer of the law must serve out his term consecutively and has denied the request for a repeal bond. This is the Robert Christian Show. Stay tuned.
You're watching The Robert Christian Show. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
And good day, ladies and gentlemen, wherever around the world that you are. Keeping one foot on the straight and narrow and the other foot, let's just play around with it just a little bit. And let's see what we can come up with today on the show. And thank you, Mr. Announcer. And we do, ladies and gentlemen, we do have our special guest, Marilyn Redmond. She is going to be joining us here shortly. So stay tuned. We're going to be talking with Miss Marilyn. High levels in Flint, Michigan. Have you heard this news story? Water has prompted President Barack Obama to declare a state of emergency in the city, as criticism mounts over this, the slow response to the crisis of lead in the water. We are continuing on with that news story as we hear of it. From Cairo, Egypt, Egyptian authorities have anticipated a crackdown on dissent ahead of next week's anniversary of the country's 2001 Arab Spring Rising, which police are raiding apartments, seeking signs and plans of organized protests, and checking people on social media and on their accounts to find out if they are planning on trying once again to, in quotation, shut it down. In other news, on Wednesday, Walmart announced that its mid-February 1.2 million employees at its U.S. stores will be getting a small raise hourly. Wages for full-time Walmart employees will increase from $13 an hour to $13.38 an hour. And for part-time employees, well, you get the picture. They will be going from $10 to $10.58 an hour. Unfortunately, the news says that that is still lower than the average for the U.S. retail workers, according to the Labor Department, which is at $14.95 per hour.
When is enough enough? Ladies and gentlemen, is a good question of the day. It really is. A controversial bill that would have nullified the U.S. Supreme Court's landmark ruling on gay marriage in Tennessee was halted with the committee stage on Wednesday. The House's Civil Justice Subcommittee voted 4-1 against the Tennessee Natural Marriage Defense Act, sponsored by Republican Mark Pawdy, to whom he said God told him to do this because gay marriage was wicked. Well, that's what he said. Gay marriage is wicked. Oh, you know what? He has got... I don't know about this guy. I'd like to talk to him. I've talked to worse people, right? Trust me, he would have to come. You all get the picture. Hey, folks, today in hour two of the... I can go on with that, and I can make fun of this guy. In hour two, the second hour of today's show, why are... This is a top-tier question, and I'm going to be doing an entire show on it. It's incredible. An incredible question, well-crafted, well-worded, but I want your opinion. And that is this: why are Americans and their rights being voted away? Gun ownership healthcare, marriage, all of this, and many wonder, why is America going down the tubes? Well, we need to look at Congress. And I'm going to be, the one to explain to everybody in one aspect or another really what's going on. Shall I really? Stay tuned for hour two. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back with our featured guest today, Marilyn Redmond, here in just a moment's time. Stand by. Live from Washington, The Robert Christian Show. Visit us on the web at robertchristianshow.com. It is a joy, a blessing in disguise to have all of you joining us today. And let's welcome with open arms and open hearts our guest, Marilyn Redmond. Hello, Miss Marilyn.
Hello, I'm so glad to be here. Thank you for asking me.
Well, let me back up just a few months, Marilyn, because folks, this is what was very bizarre. Last year, it was sometime mid August, I think, October. Yeah, maybe it was in October. But Marilyn had contacted me through a site, and I'll leave XYZ site where it is, but she contacted me through there, and I thought, hey, this is a great idea. So I booked her for a show, and then I booked her for another show, and then I booked her for this one. The problem was that I got very ill last year, very ill, and as some of you remember, I was off for 2 weeks from the live shows because of it. It was horrible, but Marilyn, she was so genuine through all of that. She said, "Oh, no problem. We'll just book it later." And yada. And so, this is a day that we've been looking forward to.
Well, I'm so glad to be here.
Well, Marilyn, you are a spirit medium.
Yes, I do that. I channel voices from the other side. Not only psychically, but medium. That means that I not only channel people that have passed over, that are your friends and family and relatives, but I also channel Archangel Michael and other archangels, Jesus, Mother Mary, Archangel Gabriel, and Saint Germain, a variety of those that are actually of higher consciousness than those just passed over. So my channeling on the YouTube is called channeling from the higher realms.
What is the, in your work and with what you do, what is the number one question that is asked?
Oh, that's a very hard one for me to put together. Well, I think a lot of people have questions about relationships, and I do counseling. I'm a spiritual counselor. I'm internationally board certified to do regression therapy. And I also do past life therapy, and I've discovered how our past really affects our lives. And it's not just our current life, but that life that we've had in other memories. The answer is, when you get out of your ego and you are in unconditional love, there's no problems with relationships.
You know, true. You know, a lot of people, though, when it comes to past lives, some people say, you know, I completely agree with it. We all have a past life. Some completely say, no, in fact, we don't. But, you know, I am with you. I think that a lot of people, that most every human being has had a past life.
Well, we've actually had hundreds and sometimes thousands, because evolution is very slow to raise our consciousness. Back 2,000 years ago when the Bible was written, it actually had in it about past lives. And there was a council at Nicene, the Nicene Council, about 544 AD, I believe, actually took out of the Bible the references. I shouldn't say all of them. There still are maybe a dozen references still left in the Bible about past lives, but those are ignored because churches don't want to look at that. But there have been other information, too, from giving us information about past lives, people's memories. I have a friend that has a very strong memory of when he was in Lemuria and that the demolition of that continent went down. He was part of that and died at sea trying to escape it. So he still has that memory. I've helped people who were very lonely, and when she discovered what happened in the past life, we resolved it, we healed it. And like 2 years later, she came, was still coming to me for other help. And she says, you know, I'm not lonely anymore. It never came back. So sometimes we have issues in our lives we have not addressed. It's called denial. And if you say it hasn't happened, well, yes, at some point you're going to have to get real and say, there's something going on I don't understand. And that's why regression therapy, I love helping people find out what was the cause of the problem that's still happening in their life today. I had a woman show up and who was very codependent, and we were doing a regression, and in the middle of it she realized what her behavior and actions were in the situation of a relationship. She didn't want to keep recreating codependency, and she says, is that what I'm doing? I don't have to do that anymore. And she was a happy camper. So, you know, we really, what we don't know about us is what runs our lives.
Well, do you think that perhaps that what has happened in someone's present life, but in their past, maybe from a childhood or a young adult, that there is still a lot of unforgiveness from past mistakes and people today? I mean, they could be senior citizens and still living with the pain or regret of XYZ.
That's the cause of our illness. Exactly. I, from my own experience, had a childhood that was in domestic violence with abuse, and I married what I was used to. So I know from my experience, and of course being able to use regression therapy, meditation, and also some alternative medicine type of help, that anything that raises your energy into love, I've been able to heal those things that in the past caused great and grave causes for me to want to try suicide. My ex-husband was trying to kill me. I was in hell. When you talked about marriages being wicked, you don't have to be in a gay marriage to have a wicked marriage. I lived it, and he was supposedly a very he was a responsible person, I thought, when I married him. We met in college. We were both training to be teachers, and it was a marriage of hell. So it doesn't matter who the people are in the relationship. It's a matter of how are you handling your life, and are you dealing with it appropriately instead of reacting from fear? Are you handling, like you say, with forgiveness? And sending love to the situation and realizing they're teaching you to have forgiveness, have compassion, unconditional love and gratitude, because that's how you raise your consciousness into a higher consciousness of love. And we eventually, if more people do that, we will have heaven on earth.
Well, I think that what, you know, within the heartstrings of people, that yes, in fact, people want to progress, they want to move forward, but some are so dumbed down to the idea that they can't, and that they have got to remain stagnant right where they are. What do you say to those people?
Well, I would encourage them to read my upcoming book. It's called Paradigm Busters, Reveal the Real You. And in there I exclaim and how we have been living in a life that we are actually conditioned to that fear and closed-mindedness and not questioning and not getting answers that are the truth. We have been proselytized with all kinds of misinformation and lies and information that is not accurate, and not only government but health issues we were talking about before the program, and also churches, school. I'm a retired school teacher, and when they started promoting all this testing, I'm not against testing if it's done for the right reasons, but the right reasons in this case was teach the child for the test and not let them use their right brain for creativity, for imagination, for listening to their inner inspiration. Teach the child to become a robot and just be able to answer the lessons on the test. And therefore, when you have only left brain experiences, the real person becomes unavailable and emotionally gone, they're too afraid to speak up against it. They're thinking in a box, and when you stay in the box, all the little demons are in there, and they run your life. And we've not been really encouraged to question those belief systems we've been taught. And so as you open the box, Pandora's box, and let the light in, you discover there's a lot of things, like in the history books, as totally not the way it happened. But we have been taught that because the victors get to write the history books. So there's a lot of things that we've not been told in medicine. And I bring this to the opening of people understanding that the AMA was invented, actually, by Rockefeller in the early 1900s to actually promote drug selling pharmaceuticals for his pocketbook. So it's not really for health. The drugs are poison prescriptions. You know, they're just like street drugs, only it comes from a doctor. In my case, they were killing me. And I had to find other answers, and that's how I turned to spirituality, because spirituality taught me I could love myself and I could listen to my heart, and I didn't have to hear what they had to say, because what they're telling me isn't the truth, and my heart will tell me the truth. And I started to change my life, and that's what my book is about. It's a step-by-step. Each chapter has a new principle of living in love in your life instead of fear, so that you can start incorporating into your activities and your thinking and your behaviors and those things around you. You can start handling your life in a new perception that will actually bring back huge emotional rewards, and you'll become emotionally available instead of just being an ice. I was an ice cube. I was afraid to feel anything. And today, you know, I'm alive and well and healthy, and they told me I would be on medicines the rest of my life, and I'm here to say the diagnosis doesn't have to be a lifetime cure, because it was killing me. And so we can really outgrow our old thinking. We can outgrow and mature. And as we mature in our lives, we start to be healthier people, and without some of the things we've been taught in the past, that we really truly are empowered inside in our hearts. And we are not victims. We don't have to play that role.
Well, what I think is quite entertaining, I guess, for what it is, Marilyn, is that you talk about being a spiritualist or dealing in the spiritual realm, but you have not mentioned, not one time, the issue of religion, which I'm glad that you haven't. I brought that up because a lot of time people, they look at spiritual issues as a religion issue and not as a real McCoy real deal issue, which it is. Two different things.
They're definitely two different things. Religion teaches dogma and it teaches creeds. I was raised with, you read the creed in the hymnal every Sunday. Those are all man-made rules, and then they reinforce if you don't think like the rule they've set up, then you don't belong. And so, you know, the reality, if you want a big laugh, is churches are the biggest cults there are, because you have to think like they think or they kick you out. And so in spirituality, you get to go into your heart instead of your head, and you get to listen to that silent voice inside that is your guidance and your direction, the love inside that wants to come out and manifest in your life. And there's no rules. There's no right and wrong. There's nothing that you can do. It's always learning lessons that you have to change from some old behavior into new behavior so that you get better loving results. And in my case, I went to church all my life, and I was living in hell in domestic violence. I became very conscious of getting out of my head into my heart. Left a church. I've left several churches at this point. I don't go into dogma anymore because that doesn't work for me. And the love of unconditional love is not really practiced in churches. They talk about it, but they don't. They're very judgmental, in my opinion. That's what I've discovered in various churches. They're very critical of you if you don't do it the way they do it. And you get to be an individual when you're spiritual. You get to be led by love of what's true for you, and to use your talents the way you see this, they are best. Your life should be the way it's. Nobody is a rubber stamp, and that's what churches tend to do. That's what schools tend to do. Even medicine gives you labels, you know. And I found out, you know, all these things that you're sick with are just labels, and in my counseling, I help change the root cause, and we don't worry about the symptoms. It's where did this come from, and you're not labeled. It's just a behavior or a thought pattern we can change, and you don't have to be sick. You don't have to take medicines. So it's a matter of, are you being true to yourself, or are you listening to others? I had to, you know, my church said don't get a divorce. Well, he's beating me up every Sunday afternoon after I've been in church all morning. My medicine said you're going to be sick the rest of your life with, you know, bipolar. Well, I've been off all medications for over 14 years, and guess what? I got sane. So, you know, what they tell you isn't necessarily what you need to hear. And, you know, this, like I say, teaching to the test doesn't get – when I taught school, I did it much more creatively than what teachers are allowed to do today. It's a crime.
Marilyn, let's take a short break. When we come back, I want to talk about teaching people and in this way. And maybe you can, as a retired school teacher, maybe you can appreciate this. Mm-hmm. But I've, ladies and gentlemen, I've always believed in this. And I've always said that herein lies a problem, because teachers teach according to a book and not necessarily according to how that student can actually learn. That's what I think. Oh, my goodness. So I'm going to bring this up to Marilyn when we come back. And I want to find out, is this true when it comes to spirituality and doing what Marilyn does in the world of the spirits? Ooh, is it all spooky now? We'll find out. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Robert Christian Show. Don't go too far, right? Hey, let's have a little fun. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
All right.
Good. Well, you're bringing up tough subjects.
Hey, I always do.
This will be controversial, you know. Yeah, I've got my water right here.
Live from Washington, the Robert Christian Show. We are pleased to have you all on the show today. Yep. Hey, what was the most ridiculous thing that you received in the mail? Was it a giveaway for something that didn't exist? Was it maybe it was a car deal. And the car deal never existed to begin with. You know what? A friend of mine actually had that happen to him. Oh, boy. I don't know, folks, what you all think of that. But it's bait and switch, and we have enough bait and switch, I think, in today's world. We don't need any more. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back with our featured guest, Marilyn Redmond, and welcome back.
Well, I'm glad to be here.
Okay, Marilyn. Let's get down to the nitty gritty with things with this question. And you know, I do ask the hard questions that people would like to know. But here is a twofold or a trifold question for you, and that is in the element of teaching. Now, in spirituality and in dealing with the spiritual world, there has to be a teaching that goes along with it. You can't just pick it up and, it can't be that way. But when it comes to teaching your kids in school, or your kids that are in college, a problem that I'm seeing more and more is that teachers teach by the book and they don't teach by the spirit of that book or the spirit of that lesson. Why aren't they?
Well, they're being told how to conduct education. As I was leaving school, we found a program that actually did what you were talking about in trying to teach through your inner innate ability and learning it through actually expanding on your knowledge and letting it enhance your life rather than memorizing from a book. It was called the Slingerland program, and it was devised for dyslexic children, and we discovered it worked beautifully for everybody. They were, the children that weren't dyslexic were just excelling in spelling, reading, comprehension, all kinds of language arts skills. I could go on. I taught it for 10 years. It was marvelous. So we took it to the administrator and said, you know, this is going to save textbook money because it's teacher administered. We were trained of how to do this, and we demonstrated and modeled what we did, and then the kids, that's how they were learning. Not from reading a book, but from the modeling. So we went and said, this works really well. You're going to save money with, you don't need a penmanship book. You don't need a reading book. Just whatever you have is workable. You don't have to buy new books. You don't have to have an English book. You don't have to have, there was, you know, a multitude of things that it was going to not be, it would really save money. And it really was successful. You don't need the spelling workbook that was just everybody wanted to burn because it was worthless. And you know what the administrator said? The school board will not know what page of the book you're on. And they just kiboshed it immediately because they don't have any control then. So it's all about controlling what the child is receiving and not letting them develop their own abilities, as you suggested. And they don't want that kind of labor force. If you think out of the box and you learn to think for yourself, and become a leader, you're going to oust them out of their position of control and manipulation of the public.
Well, I brought that up to begin with, Marilyn, because a lot of our students, a lot of our children, are being dumbed down by a book and not being wised up by real life experiences. And you offer both, Marilyn. As a retired school teacher, you understand the value of teaching out of a book, but your teaching goes beyond what is on the pages of a book and into real life experience. That's the cream of the crop, if you ask me.
I wrote an article when I retired, because I'm a lifetime member of the Teachers Association. I wrote an article for their magazine and about returning back to the old way of teaching, which I learned in the 50s and 60s when I went through training, when Dewey and Maslow and some of Piaget and some of the other people that Horace Mann started education, and that was what they were teaching was to the child, you know, the child's talents to develop. And I wrote an article expressing this, and, you know, they said, we loved your article, but we can't print it yet. People are being controlled and dominated by a secret agenda that is hidden from them, and they don't even know it, and it's time to wake up and see beyond what the news tells you at night, beyond what you read in the newspapers, beyond all the publicity and propaganda that's out there, because we are being led by our noses, and like lemmings, we're falling right off the cliff. So it's time to wake up and see, where is all this coming from? Why are people not allowed to be, you know, that's what I have against IQ tests. IQ tests do not test intelligence. It tests the ability of a person to perform on a skill either they've learned or acquired somewhere. And it's only for that time and day that they accomplished that particular task. And that's what that score is. If somebody has a talent in another position that is not even tested, they ignore it and say, you're dumb, you don't have any ability, you don't have 120 IQ. They might be a terrific artist, but where's that on the test? They might be a terrific mechanic, but where's that on the test? It's all about just, you know, what they're looking for is to keep children thinking as memorizing the book, as you mentioned, and just repeating it. And that's like being a parrot, you know. That's not training and really educating. Educating is to pull out the abilities of a person. People like Bill Gates say education is to put it in. Well, that's what they're wanting to do. We'll tell you what to think. We'll tell you how to handle your life. We'll give you the answers. Well, that doesn't work because you have to do it for yourself. And so they kibosh everybody having initiative and curiosity and to go out there and search and seek for answers they're looking for. They kibosh that with the testing. And it's a shame. It's just Real shame.
I look at it, you know, the educational system, and then here is yet another layer. Ladies and gentlemen, look at it this way, because it is layered. It has to be layered. You have the educational system, which is a foundation. Now, I'm not saying it is the only foundation or a good foundation or a bad one, but you have a foundation. And then on top of that, you have an entire different world. And that is the world of spirituality. Now, this is not talking about religion. Now, of course, we could talk about God all we want, but this is not talking about God in that sense. It is talking about being a spiritualist, being able to look beyond the call of duty when it comes to what is actually in a book. Now, Marilyn, with what you do as a spirit guide, I know that a lot of people ask you a lot of questions, and sometimes it's like the same question over and over, maybe by just different people. But are the results always the same? Are they spot on, or are they something that just come to you?
Well, yes, you know, and you did mention about different schools teaching different things, and if you wanted to a spiritual school, you would send your children to a Waldorf school or a Montessori school. And then they would have more creativity and investigative curiosity. It would be more of their abilities being enhanced and enlarged and encouraged and supported. You know, and you were talking about what are the questions? You know, the biggest question that everybody needs to look at is, are they coming from their head or are they coming from their heart? And when you're in fear, you come from your head for survival. And that's when we get conflict. That's when we get us and them. That's when we get wars. That's when we get feeling needy and unworthy. We feel lack of in our lives. We have to have more, more, more. That's addiction to replace it. So when you come from your heart and you're spiritual, you're looking at the invisible energy that supports the universe, that created the universe, that loves you in unconditional ways, that brings to you everything you need. You're not needy anymore. You have the worth of the universe, gives you your worth, or you can call it God, but you can also call it love. There's many, many terms that can be used instead of God. But the spirit of the loving energy that is in all of us needs to be opened up, knock on your heart, and open the door to a higher consciousness of unconditional love, where there's no criticism, judgment, or condemnation. And when you open up into love, you have everything you need, everything you wanted, and your life is happy, harmonious, and in balance. So what we have on planet Earth right now is what we call third dimension of duality, good, bad, right, and wrong. You know, critical. My mother was very critical of me, and I said once to her, why? And she says, well, if I don't tell you what's wrong with you, who will? You know, children need to be loved and nurtured. I was not nurtured as a child. I did not even know what love was. That's how I got in domestic violence. I didn't know how there was a universe that loved me and supported me and was with, created me. I learned a lot of things in Sunday school and church that didn't benefit me, because my life was, I was really a Cinderella when my mother remarried, and I had a stepfather, and he says, well, we don't spoil Marilyn, and his mother said, well, we won't treat you like a granddaughter because you're not of our blood. That's mm-hmm. not spiritual. We're all one in a loving energy, and we're to embrace everybody and support everybody and let them know that we care about them. And when you do that, your life improves, and you feel good about yourself, and you start being in joy instead of this depression. Depression is darkness. And when we let the light of the spirit in, the darkness leaves. You walk into a dark room and turn on the light, what happens? So spirituality brings us out of the depression, out of the illness. You can't be sick if you're happy and whole and healthy and in love. Sickness is the lack of that energy working in your life. That's why alternative medicine works. It raises your energy out of the darkness, out of the depression, out of the separation from that spiritual energy that's missing. And it has to flow through you. So when you go to acupuncture, Reiki, chiropractic help, Chinese doctors, anything that, Qigong, I do Qigong with people, anything that raises your energy into a more loving place is going to improve your life, and you're going to be happy, and you're going to be in joy, and you're going to be helping people. You're going to go out and volunteer and say, what can I do to help with you? I'm okay. Right. I've got everything I need. What can I do to help you have that happiness too?
Marilyn, and ladies and gentlemen, I will say this. Marilyn, she is loaded, isn't she? Right? She came prepared, and I love that. I absolutely love it when guests come on the show and they come prepared. They come loaded up and ready for action. Marilyn is, and if you pay attention, Marilyn, as I've been paying attention to what you've been saying, you came loaded with both barrels loaded. You're ready to go. You're but a lot of people, it has taken you a long time, though, to get to where you are. So for somebody, Marilyn, and okay, I know the question. Hey, it's New Age theory or New Age teaching. I don't think that it is, Marilyn. This is older than the hills. But people are just now coming to realize this and coming to understand this. And you're talking about love, the frequency of love, what is in the heart. You know, it needs to be full of love, not full of hate and vinegar.
Well, it is older than the hills. It's older than the Bible. This whole situation, actually, having a loving energy in us was actually many thousands of years ago. The masters, you've heard of masters, Jesus was a master. He mastered his emotions to be able to move into unconditional love. He came to be the example, not a religion, but an example that everyone could raise their energy into this unconditional love. Now, there's many masters out there over the years, and you've heard of them as Buddha, Muhammad, Saint Germain, the upper Pythagoras. There's, you know, they go on and on. Okay, there's lots of masters have done this. They went through what they called initiations. Mm-hmm. And what I finally have understood is initiations is removing the fear and the ego, the guilt, the shame, so that you move out of that. It just leaves your system, so you move into this unconditional love where your life is really delightful, full of light. And so we have people today, I've been able to move into the light today and have Christ consciousness, which is another term for unconditional love. But they didn't understand that word 2,000 years ago. And so the Bible is really has a lot of message and spirit in it if you don't stick to the words. If you see the spirit behind the words, it's saying that we can mature into loving people on the planet. We do not have to be at odds with others. They're our brothers and sisters. When we love each other, then you're loving your neighbor as yourself, because that's the energy you send out. See, that's what I didn't get as a child. My parents couldn't love themselves. My mother was mentally ill. My dad was an alcoholic. My mother married somebody even sicker. Okay, so I did not have parents that could nurture me and love me. When I became spiritual and started learning that God or whoever you choose for a higher power could love me, and I didn't have to look to people for my worth, I didn't have to look to them for my validation, that I really was a person that had some meaning and I had a purpose, and I didn't have to pay attention to those things outside of me. They're really insane. What sanity's inside, the great reality's inside, it's just been covered by all that calamity that we go through because people are so fearful and they hurt others in the process. And that's, we don't need prisons and jails. Those are wounded people that are looking for love, but they don't know how and where to find it. That's where my next coming book is so valuable, is actually I'll show them how. My last book was called The Real Meaning of 2012, A New Paradigm to Bring Heaven to Earth. And it shows that we can release the influence of the ego. And now this book shows you the exact details of how to do it. Churches sell, will do it, but they don't. No one tells you how. And so I wrote a book that shows you exactly how to change your life from being in your head and all the turmoil, crisis, and chaos. You remember the old TV show Get Smart?
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
Who was the enemy? Chaos.
Yes.
We get to move out of the chaos into the love of the universe that's always been there. We've had blinders and earplugs on, and now we can take them off because it's safe. Nobody changes until they feel safe. And this book shows you how to feel safe so you can become that person you were created to be, and you could be happy in your life doing it.
Well, you know, Marilyn, I will say this. As far as the religion or the church, the religious church goes, that there are more people that are hurting, more people that are wounded that sit in the pews of these churches than people that are healed. And maybe what America and maybe what the world needs is an all-out deliverance from the spirit of religion and be introduced to a spirituality.
Well, it's not New Age. It's really a reclamation of old information that was suppressed.
You're right.
It was suppressed to keep people manipulated and controlled for the rich or elite or cabal, however you choose to call that organization.
Yep.
And we can move out of it today. We can say, well, we don't buy into the fear anymore because fear's an illusion.
Amazing.
False illusions appearing real. We don't have to buy into your propaganda. We don't have to buy into your threats. 9/11 doesn't scare us because it was all planned and predicted, and it was from people trying to keep fear in the lives of people. So we can move beyond that today. We have the ability, the energy of the universe supports our moving out of fear today. I have become fearless. About a year ago, I became fearless. It has changed my life so much, I cannot explain how. I remember the movie star saying, Katharine Hepburn saying, she was raised to be fearless. I was amazed it could even happen. And
yes.
She was raised that way? Wow, well, I have accomplished that. I am very thrilled to say I don't have that same kind of fear I used to have.
But Marilyn, though, in order to live fearless, there has to be a spiritual awakening that has happened to you.
Yes. It's a commitment to live and not die. I was the walking dead for 45 years. I tried suicide. I wanted out. Now, 30 years later, you know, I'm 76. 30 years later, I know how to release all the things that got in the way, and that's what the book's about. And, you know, on my website, Angelica's Gifts, I have all kinds of information. I'm on YouTube with a lot of lectures and information and interviews that people can use. I have books on Amazon.com that are spiritually oriented. And I have a blog, MarilynRedmondBooks.blogspot.com. And I try to tell people, you know, you can have a happier life. You can have more prosperity and abundance in your life if you allow it to come in. Open your heart and receive.
Okay, let's back up just a second, Marilyn. What again is your website address?
My website is Angelica's Gifts, AngelicasGifts.com. Angelica is my major angel that has kept me alive. In my first book, I told about many problems in my growing up, the trauma and drama that I experienced, and she and Archangel Michael and four other angels kept me alive through my childhood and other lifetimes, so that today I can share with people we don't have to die. Our spirit lives forever. We are going through a spiritual experience as human beings. And we can leave the human being part behind and be spiritual people in loving hearts, where we come together in unity and cooperation and caring, like I mentioned, where we can help each other and support each other and be there for each other in ways that are honest and true. And we can do so much more from love than you can from fear. You know, the spirit of love is amazing. It feels like heaven on earth, and we can accomplish that. I'm here to say I've accomplished it. We can accomplish that.
And your books, you have written more than one book, and all of them are on Amazon. Is that correct?
Yes, they are. And well, also, I've been included last year in three anthologies about success. So if you went onto Amazon and checked, one's called The Book of Success, one's Hidden Success, and Walking Your Life. I'm also in those anthologies, hoping to be in some more that are coming up. So, yes, it's amazing that the information's there, and when we apply it to our lives, when we say, I'm worth it, I have faith and trust that all things are going to work for good. And when we actually have that faith, it's like you can put toast in the toaster and you're going to still, you can put bread in the toaster, you're still going to have bread. When you plug it into the electricity, that's the spirit. When you plug it in, it can actually pop up and make toast. But you can sit on the counter for the rest of your life and not be toast.
Now, Marilyn, we're going to take another break here. But when we come back, I want to ask you some personal questions, some personal data. And one of them of which that I think that a lot of people would be very intrigued to know, and that is this: what was it in your life that was your either your aha moment or your spiritual awakening from such a sleep into the woman that you are today? And of course, how can you be able to help other people? What is your goal behind that? Folks, this is the Robert Christian Show, where your voice, your opinion, they matter. We'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen, with our featured guest. Seconds. And we are back with our featured guest, Marilyn Redmond. And, you know, it is a joy, Marilyn, having you on. It really is, for a lot of reasons. But one question I know that resonates in a lot of people's mind is, what was for you your aha moment, the moment of your awakening? What caused that?
Well, I'll give a little bit of history to go with it so you can understand where I came from. Being raised in a family of mental illness, alcoholism, sex addiction, and rageaholic, lots of anger, that's all I knew. And I was conditioned into that. I went to a church that was very fundamental, which told me I was a sinner and I would go to hell, so to speak. And I knew there was a God, but I wasn't worthy. I wasn't good enough. Good things didn't happen to me, thank you. So I had a lot of indoctrination of that I was a bad person and I needed to be prove myself. I'm a workaholic overachiever, trying to make you think I'm okay. And I found out today I am okay. But that momentum brought me into a marriage of domestic violence, which I was used to, was familiar. And because things got so bad, I was drinking with my husband. He was an alcoholic. I found out alcoholism is a genetic hereditary disposition that I had went from birth. So you add alcoholism to that, I got addicted, and then I went to the psychiatrist for help and got prescriptions, and that addicted me more. One pill and one drink is six times the effect. I was becoming crazier and crazier over what was going on in my life, and nothing was getting better, so I tried suicide. Angels came, that's in my first book, and then when my husband tried to kill me several times, that was the aha. I didn't know in those days I had a death wish. I wanted out of the hell I was living in. I went to church in the mornings and in the afternoon. If I was really tired from teaching all week and I really needed some rest, he'd pick me up out of bed, put me outside and say, well, if I'm working in the yard, you are too. So that's just one example of, you know, but the things got worse and worse, so that he was trying to kill me. And that night I knew I wouldn't go home alive. We were in a car. He was going to show me. And I prayed out of my heart. Now, I'd been raised Lutheran and I always used the hymnal for the prayers. But in this night, I was so scared. I said, God, please help me. I really don't want to die. And we were off the highway. We almost had two front-end collisions that night, plus his being all over the road like a maniac. And it scared the dickens out of me. And so we were off the road. He passed out for the rest of the night. We were coming home from a vacation at Harrison Hot Springs, so we were in Canada. And I was scared spitless because emotionally I was 3 years old in those days. And so to be left in a Canadian place was not for me. I needed to get back in the States and I'd get out of the car. Well, he wouldn't let me out of the car. And so he ended up in AA and he said, Good Wives of Alcoholics, go to Al-Anon. That was my first introduction to spirituality. Al-Anon is a spiritual program along with AA. I did not know I was codependent to about 9 or 10 people and situations. And I had to learn to trust myself, get into my heart and release all those things that stopped my codependency, which was, I drank over that trying to have courage. I was a very three-year-old emotionally unavailable child in a marriage, 30-year marriage of battering and abuse and rape. And so when I prayed that prayer, within days, doors started to open for help. And I have been using those tools and the help I received for the last 30 years. And that's what's in the book, is what I've learned over the last 30 years of moving out of that hell. I have healed all my addictions, all my medical problems, all the things that were causing difficulties, and my arthritis is almost gone, and that's the last medical condition. I've used alternative medicine for that. I've been off all prescriptions for over 14 years, sober for over 30 years at this point, and I don't use anything toxic in my system to stop my clear thinking of being rational, and I can grow up.
Well, you know, I think that you've done quite well for yourself, Marilyn, and, you know, it is, ladies and gentlemen, it is a spiritual awakening. Again, you know, we're not talking about awakening, waking somebody up in the name of religion or in the name of, some God somewhere or some idea somewhere, but a spiritual awakening, that is so so personal. And Marilyn, oh, I hear a telephone ringing. Marilyn, she is able, folks, to explore, to experiment, to love, to live, and to show other people what they can do in their life to make it better. Marilyn, I've got about 5 minutes with you left in today's interview, but what would you like to leave our audience with?
Well, I think the best thing I would like to leave is what I learned is I can't expect other people to change. I'm the one that had to change. I prayed at one point to God. I says, I do not want another 30-year battering and abusive marriage. And I found out I had to become the person I wanted for that partner to be in my life. And I made a list, and spiritual was at the top, honest, sincere, integrity, and those kinds of terms of what you would want. Honesty is very important, I found out. My husband was not honest. So I started practicing what you might call the fruits of the spirit. And one day, for 1 week, I would take one word and try to put that into my activities and my behavior. And gradually I started to find I was changing. And so when I change, I create my reality. Everything around me changes. The love can leave today. My heart is open. The love can leave and spread the path in front of me so it's smooth and harmonious today. When my heart is shut, I'm sending out fear and love, and I perpetuated that domestic violence because I was trying to protect myself. The best protection is to be totally open to the love. Nobody can hurt you when you're totally open to love. There's nothing to retaliate. You don't have to defend yourself. You are in the safety and security of that spirit that is there for you. You actually stop it when you try to pretend defend yourself. So to be totally vulnerable and change yourself, open up your heart and let that love flow out to others. Be what you could be. Be the person you want others to be. Start being at yourself.
That's right. You know, I've said for a long time, Marilyn, if we want to see change in the world that we live in, then be that change.
That's what I've learned, and I've attracted a 14-year relationship of unconditional love. So it's just it works. I'm living proof that when you change yourself, you attract a healthier, better life that is unbelievable. It's still getting better all the time.
Absolutely. Well, Marilyn, I do want to take this opportunity to thank you once again for coming on today's live show, and I will send you the link to the interview as soon as that it is published and put up.
Oh, well, thank you for having me. I'm just real thrilled, and this was a real good time. Thank you so much.
Awesome, Marilyn. Well, we do greatly appreciate you, and good luck in the future with your future endeavors, and would love to have you back on again.
I would love that. I would like it very much.
Awesome.
I'm going to be doing workshops with my book, so maybe we can tell the people the information of where the workshops will be.
Yeah. Do you have the information now?
No, I just know it'll be this spring at the in Normandy Park, but I don't have the date yet because the book isn't published yet, but it will be in 2 months.
All right. Well, fantastic. Well, as that day does approach, then get a hold of me again, and we can see what we can do to jostle schedules around so we can get you back on.
Oh, that would be wonderful. Thank you so much, Robert. I really like that.
Awesome. Well, thank you once again, Marilyn.
Oh, and have a good evening.
You too. Bye-bye for now. Wow. All right, ladies and gentlemen, Marilyn Redmond, we are honored to have had Marilyn on. We had hoped to have had Marilyn on sometime last year, actually. But things did not work out that way. I guess it just wasn't meant to happen at that moment in time. But today, Marilyn, she shares a fantastic idea, a fantastic way of life. And I think that is delish. Hey, folks, on the web, you can visit us on the web at robertchristianshow.com. The only address that you need. There you can find information about our shows, about the live show, the interviews that we've done, celebrity interviews, and more. Yeah, there is a whole lot more. Wow. So we're going to be getting into some other things online on our website that you won't find on our live shows. Two different pieces of content. Isn't that great? That's delish. Hey, folks, in hour two, so upcoming on the Robert Christian Show, why are Americans' rights being voted away? Gun ownership. All right, that's a healthy debate right there, isn't it? Healthcare, marriage equality, all being voted away. The educational system. Thank you, Marilyn. The educational system in the States being sold down the river. We all know this. But many wonder who is buying it. And if we bring a challenge to these matters, what would that challenge actually be? I'm Robert Christian. Ladies and gentlemen, stay tuned for more of the Robert Christian Show up next. Did you know that there is a lot of people who have imitated the Robert Christian Show? Well, why settle for the imitation when you can have the real thing? Join us Fridays, 3 p.m. Pacific Time, that is 6 p.m. Eastern, right here for the Robert Christian Show. Visit us online at robertchristianshow.com. And please, subscribe to our YouTube channel, folks. You can look us up on YouTube. We've got 300 and some odd videos on YouTube, and it is growing. Hey, we want to invite you also to be a part of our membership. Folks, hey, membership is free. You just show up, right? Hey, that's pretty simple. If you don't like the show, well, you don't like it. But you know what? There's a lot of people who do enjoy the shows, and I hope that you're one of them. Folks, robertchristianshow.com. That's all that you need. RobertChristianShow.com. Don't settle for the imitations.
The Robert Christian Show will be back on the air, folks, in just a moment's time. Don't go too far.